Ah, there we go. Okay, so welcome to lecture 3 of ECE 5312. And so we're going to look at this lecture one step further in terms of looking at noise, looking at power spectral densities, looking at random processes, looking at LTI systems. And what we're going to do now is we're going to look at a very specific case of noise, of randomness, which is called narrowband noise. Okay, so narrowband noise. So what is this narrowband noise? What's NB noise? And so narrowband noise is essentially when you transmit a signal. So let's say we bring this up on the project, not the projector, but on the screen. So what happens is in a communication system, let's go into the frequency domain, right? Yay. So in the frequency domain, we have a signal, let's say that it looks like that. That's its power spectral density. And then there's noise. And that's what we don't want, okay? So that's like the noise floor. And that's our signal. What we want to do is we know that a communication system, a receiver, is going to take this, okay? And it's going to band select. It's going to take out. Going to filter out that portion of signal. So what we get at the end of the day is ideally that signal, the desired PSD. But we're going to have a bit of that residual noise in there too, so the residual noise. Okay. So what happens is your RF front end of your radio system, per se, does not take everything across frequency and say, I'm going to process this. I'm going to get the information out of this. It's going to say, I'm going to select. This is the band where my information is and pull it out, but some noise is going to be present in that selection. So what the problem is, and you might see this already, so I'm going to use Mr. Pink Dashed. So what's really cool, let's say that pink dashed line represents approximately the power spectral density of the noise. Nice, flat power spectral density. There are some very attractive properties, which I'll talk about a little bit later about that. But primarily, what happens is when we have a flat power spectral density for the noise, like let's say it's equal to n naught over 2 or whatever it is, that means it's uncorrelated in the time domain, right? Because what is a constant in the frequency domain equal to? A delta in the time domain. Now, look what happens with our noise now. There's some flatness, right? But then, it goes down. It's now this rectangular pulse thing. And now we lose that beautiful uncorrelatedness property, which we were hoping for. So we need to somehow characterize this noise in this context. And so that's what this entire lecture is all about. What happens? Scary, it's actually not that bad. About that particular signal, we're using an LTI filter. So what we're doing is we're also filtering out this big LTI filter. The power spectral density of the input to an LTI system multiplied by the transfer function magnitude squared of that LTI equal to the power spectral density of the output, this is already very powerful. So we now know statistically it's going to be, but them actually. So to accomplish that, so for instance, how does this look like? How does this noise look like? Is if we had some sort of, like, you know, if we plotted over time what our noise signal looks like, right? What happens is the envelope of this signal here actually represents the noise signal at DC, but what's happening is it's being modulated by higher frequencies. So this is kind of a problem. So what ends up happening is, let's say if we filter out the signal at two specific instances using that cosine modulated filter approach, right? Let's say we have a signal, the desired signal at f of c and minus f of c, and so we filter those out, we're filtering out those noise, that noise is cosine modulated, it will look like this. It will basically look like the noise signal itself, and just like an AM signal, it's actually the envelope, and the envelope's being defined by this shaped sinusoidal representation. So, you know, things get well, we turn to math, obviously, but we have two types of representation. So there, you can represent noise one of two ways. You can either do in-phase and quadrature representation. All it is, really, do you want to work in Cartesian coordinates, or do you want to work in spherical, right? So the in-phase is like an XY, it's Cartesian. So I have, in the real axis, I have this much noise. In the imaginary axis, I have that much noise. Envelope and phase, on the other hand, is, okay, my noise is, like, let's say, X, is this far away with this phase. Okay, so, like, phasor representation. And so, here's this little blurb on how you do complex base. Complex noisy signal represented either as A plus JB, right? So A represents the real and B represents the imaginary portion of that noise. Or I can represent it by capital A, E to the J phi. Of two ways. You choose. So we can either, we have both forms. So we can represent narrowband noise in terms of I and Q or envelope and phase. They're equivalent, right? So what we'll do is let's look at I and Q first. So if we have narrowband noise in terms of I and Q, what we have is we can represent our complex envelope of our narrowband noise signal, the complex baseband, as nt tilde equal to ni t plus j and q of t. So that's our real and imaginary component of noise. Okay. And what happens is the bandpass version, when we the complex baseband is radio frequencies, this communications is happening. We only care about, okay, for some carrier frequency, maybe even at zero, this is our representation of our signal before we modulate it up. And this here, the nt, so this is different. Nt is equal to the real, the envelope of e to the j, 2 pi fc of t. That's the modulator over to fc, and we take the real because of the envelope. And so if we take this one step further, what we do is, let's suppose we want to represent that nt in terms of ni of t and nq. That if you use Euler, let's actually do that. And let's use the smart tablet. Okay. What ends up happening is n of t. Erase. So you take n of t, and it's equal to the real. Okay? Now, what ends up happening is we use Euler's relation, ER. That's what happens if you do too much of these mathematics. What ends up happening is you have n tilde of t cosine 2 pi fc of t, and then plus j sine 2 pi fc of t. I might be missing a term, so my apologies. Not important, it's only a constant. Now, let's also expand out what this guy is. He is going to be equal to n I of t plus j n q of t. We multiply this out. We're going to have four terms. We discard the imaginary terms. So what are we left with? We should have an n I of t and a cosine, and that will be real. And when we have a j n q of t multiplied by a j sine 2 pi fc of t, that's going to be minus n q of t sine 2 pi fc of t. And then the cross terms and stuff, they all have j's in it, and the real operator here actually gets rid of it, right? So at the end, we have that expression. And so with this expression, now what happens is when I talk about, let's say, representing noise, so we have this representation, and so Ni is the in-phase, and Nq is the quadrature representation. So if I ever wanted to create narrowband noise using Ni and Nq, or extract such noise, what I would do is the following. I would essentially my Nt, I want to extract the Ni and Nq. The process. What you would do is you would take the Nt, multiply it by cosine 2 pi fc of t and sine 2 pi fc of t, and then low pass filter. And you might say, okay, why? How do I get that? Well, what happens is, what happens when you represented by these things here, and multiplied by the same frequency, you get a cosine of double that frequency and a DC term. Okay? These are trig identities, right? So what happens is, what does the filter do? Cuts out the double frequency terms. The only thing that's going to pass through that low-pass filter will be the DC term. And what's that DC term? It's going to be, right? Because that's term, which will be any frequency term, which is also taken care of by the low-pass filter. If you want to synthesize narrowband noise using Ni and Nq, you do exact opposite, but there's no low-pass filter, right? So the beauty of this sort of representation is that we can use a combination of simple low-pass filters, modulators, and if we know what Nt or Ni of t and Nq of t are, we can mix and match and make these representations very easily, right? So the next slide, I'm going to go through it somewhat quickly, but it should be taken with great warning, okay? I think, for lack of a better word. Somehow my vocabulary is just never, ever good enough, so I use some dramatic words. But I would heed this slide, because what happens is, if you're ever given a question on narrowband noise, I and Q representation, this list of properties is actually extremely useful. Okay? So I just summarized it. It's like a laundry list of everything under the sky about narrowband noise, I and Q representations. So like, for instance, Ni and Nq are zero mean if Nt is zero mean, right? If Nt is Gaussian, then those Ni and Nqs are jointly Gaussian. Remember, like the question you asked about the two domains, what happens is you would have, like, what would a joint Gaussian distribution be? You know I want to draw this, right? So I just want to, I go back to the draw pad. This is so cool. I really need to buy one of these for my home. So, you know, of course, I have to then explain to my wife why I'm talking to myself. So what happens is, what would a joint Gaussian distribution, a PDF, look like? It would look like the following. So let's say that's my NI direction, I, and that's my NQ direction. If they're jointly Gaussian, I've drawn this diagram like a gajillion times, so it looks like a Gaussian in that dimension. It looks like a Gaussian in that dimension. And then, so it looks like that. It looks basically like a mountain, a Gaussian mountain that's rotated. And you can actually tell from this, based on how squished the Gaussian distribution is, the bell curve, is how much correlation. This here, I drew it perfectly symmetric around the vertical axis. And the reason for that is these are two uncorrelated directions. But if they're correlated, it will actually look kind of like squished along an axis. And the more correlated it is, the more squished it would be. Okay. Ah. I have to go back to the doc cam. Oh. So if NT is stationary, then these guys are jointly stationary, and a lot of other things. But the most important ones that seem to come out time, power spectral density of NI and NQ look like if you have N. And it turns out that if, let's say, those guys, like both NI have the same power spectral density, what that means is their power spectral density is equal to the frequency shifted version of N of the power spectral density of N of t by Fc, and both from negative Fc and plus Fc. So what does that mean? So if N of t is already modulated by Fc, what I'm essentially doing is I'm taking these two guys and bringing them back down to DC. And that's what I should get at SNI of F and SNQ of F. And then there's something called cross-spectral density, which you don't see as much. But you get this other kind of similar relationship. Like if you're trying to relate the power spectral density between the input and output, there's something called a cross-power spectral density. And they're also related by this beautiful expression. But I think a lot of cases when you deal with relating LTI systems, and this relationship comes up a lot. Okay. So, and also just for your information, I put some trig identities because in case you don't have a calculus textbook or you forgot or something like that. Okay. Okay. So let's actually do another example again from all people. Haha. Simon Haken. So this is a great example because it brings up that exact property. So in this case, what happens is we have zero mean noise. Okay, it's uncorrelated, as we'll see later on, there's something called additive white Gaussian noise, and so AWGN. So the noise is added, literally added to your transmitted signal in the channel. It's white. What does white mean? Its power spectral density is flat right across from minus infinity to infinity. It's Gaussian, which means it has a bell curve power spectral bell curve probability density function, and its noise. Party. Okay. But it butted in anyway. So what happens is we have this noise, power spectral density flat, right? Now, we're filtering out everything but the desired signal. We filter out only that flat portions of noise at those two things. And it's kind of cool because we're using the power spectrum, the in minus Fc is rectangular in shape. So what is that beautiful relationship between input and output of the power spectral density? Magnitude of this multiplied by that. What happens when you multiply zero against anything? It's zero. Multiply this, which actually has a magnitude of one. What's the square of one? Is one. Multiply that guy, H of F, is a cookie cutter of that noise. So what we end up getting is noise that is the shape of H of F magnitude squared. But it has an amplitude of n naught over 2. And that's what we get, it says of n. Now, this is great. But now I want to is the complex baseband in phase and quadrature noise contributions of this beautiful thing. That's where we bring up property number 4 of the narrowband IonQ power spectral densities, right? What ends up happening is, remember, spectral density is going to be equal to the power spectral density of the quadrature noise, which is equal to the demodulated versions of the passband noise, of the N of F. So what we do is take this guy, okay, let's shift it by minus FC. The same guy, and shift it by FC down. Boom! Add it together. Our power spectral density of the narrowband in phase and quadrature noise components will be equal to a DC-based noise contribution. Right? And it's all definition. You can prove it, but I'll let you guys do that if you really have nothing to do on a Friday night. And okay. So that's what Haken did. To in terms of autocorrelation function. Wonderful, huh? Okay. Oh, so now I'm going to stop beating that horse with IonQ, and now we're going to turn our attentions to envelope and phase. Because what more fun can one have than playing with envelope and phase? Different beast! We don't have anion, we don't have NQ, we have some sort of envelope or magnitude, some cosine, some frequency term, and then a phase. So how do we go from R of T and phase to NI of T and NQ of T? And the answer is just like what you did in pre-calculus. Well, depending on how old you guys are, for me, that's several decades ago. For others, it might be kind of recent. But what you do is you have basis functions. You go Jacobians, you're going to have to do a change of variables. You're going to have to basically change the way that stay there regardless. But how do you reflect? Is it x and y, or is it radius and angular displacements, azimuth, if you will? So what we need to do is, let's say, back to that beautiful mountain diagram. I promise I'm not going to draw. I just want to go back to it, okay? And you have this beautiful mountain diagram, right? What does that look like in terms of the joint PDF of NI and NQ? And the answer is, it is equal to joint PDF of NI to NQ. I'm white noise. E to the minus NI squared plus NQ squared divided by 2 sigma squared. So you might wonder where. Property, right? So I and NQ are uncorrelated with each other. Just like in this diagram, it's symmetric. That symmetric mountain means that they're independent. What does that mean for your PDFs? The joint PDFs should be equal to the individual marginal PDFs multiplied together. So if you look at this guy, it's like taking E to the exponent the little constant thing multiplies together, we get. Now, we know polar or spherical, no, let's say polar coordinates by these expressions here, right? So, to the radius and the phase by these expressions down. Plug it in. But there's one more caveat. So we plug it in to try and get the new probability density function, F, R, N, capital phi, rho, and phi. And it's equal to sort of the substitute version of the joint PDF of Ni and Nq, but there's that weird J thing below. What is that? That's the Jacobian. Such a cool name, Jacobian. So again, if you're hanging out with friends tomorrow or Friday night, and you want to impress them and say, yeah, I calculated Jacobian in class earlier this week. And they'll say, wow, you did? And then what happens is, take the determinant of that guy. What that guy does is, he's kind of like, he helps in the modification of your change of basis from Ni, Nq to R phi. And what you'll find is that if you do the math, what you'll see is you're going to get this thing. What's so special about that? This is your F, R, phi, R, phi. And it's actually a combination of our good friend Rayleigh, and we have 2 pi. 2 pi is not part of Rayleigh. 2 pi, if we extract it out. So the Rayleigh part is purely for the radial arm, the distance from the origin to that point in space. The 1 over 2 pi represents a uniform PDF, and that's for the phase. Hey! So that phi thing, uniform for that phase, rotation around the axis. And that R is a Rayleigh random variable. So I was mentioning earlier in class, I said, how do you create a Rayleigh random number generator from a Gaussian random number generator? This is how. What you do, essentially, if you take a complex Gaussian, which is essentially, and you assume that they're uncorrelated, so essentially all you need is 2 Gaussians, right? 1 in I and 1 in Q, and you perform this operation on that random, the outputs of those random number generators, you could create something with a Rayleigh distribution. But uniform, there are other solutions for that. So that's actually pretty cool. Coordinate setting, it's actually a big deal. Now, let's put a twist, because I'm done with this yet. So what happens is we looked at a nice case where we have noise and it's added to a signal and all that jazz. But now what happens if we add something deterministic? Let's say there's this annoying hum. Perhaps. Guess, you know, there are hums. In this room, there is a 60 hertz hum. Where is it coming from? Where is it coming from? I don't know. What happens is, cosine or sine that's existing with noisy signal somewhere. The question is now, how does this affect your joint distributions, your FNINQ and your FR phi? If you work it out, group, you combine your A, and we know that NT is represented in the NI NQ representation as a cosine and sine. So we group the cosines together. So let's say that tone or that signal or that constant or whatever that value is somehow found in that narrowband signal along with the narrowband noise. What happens is it adds a bias to the NI side. That Ni actually has A. So let me work this out. Partly because it's been a long time since I've been playing with this anyway. So now, what happens is, let's say we have A cosine 2 pi fc of t plus nt, right? So you have that plus. So now let's expand out nt. Okay, and then nq. Let me double check something. Correction, should be minus. Bad. And now what happens is let's group these guys together. So now if we have those guys together, that's going to be equal to a plus ni of t cosine 2 pi fc of t, and then minus nq of t sine, okay? And so let's call this guy. let's actually use blue here. Call it ni of t prime, okay? And what that guy does is he represents this DC bias term plus the ni term. So if we go back to our representation, we now have bias. It actually changes the mean to A. So if you had the bell curve initially at 0, with adding A to it means you're curving a class grade. Let's say class average was an abysmal 30%. Let A equal 40. But what happens is it causes some weirdness here in terms of the conversion with the power, the PDFs. What it actually does is, if you have that, this guy, so these joint PDFs, what you have is now you have a mean term here in your joint, in your sort of joint PDF, the Gaussian mountain. So you're moving mountains, if you will, by A in one direction. It turns out if you do the conversion. Oh, come on. What ends up happening is if you convert it to r and phi, you come up with another very powerful random variable, Ricean, the Ricean distribution. Oh, Bengi, you like Riceans. So Ricean is essentially, it's its distribution. Rice is usually in line of sight. And why? Because you usually have a very strong component reaching the receiver from the transmitter, and then the scatter, the stuff you'd normally have if you didn't have line of sight. And Ricean PDF is it almost looks the same as the Rayleigh, except that you have this modified Bessel function thing at the end. Oh, yeah. I think if anything scared me in undergraduate studies when I did calculus classes, it was always Bessel functions. I never did them. It's intimidating. I thought I never had to deal with them ever again after I graduated calculus. But somehow things always come back to revisit. All right. So in a nutshell, you have narrowband noise representations. So you should just be aware about these, because it will come back. Because later in this course, after we deal with how do we represent information in terms of amplitude, phase, and frequency, we're going to do performance analysis in additive white Gaussian noise channels when we have no constraint on bandwidth, when it's unlimited bandwidth. Like, imagine if you're the only one in the universe that's doing wireless signals and any spectrum goes. But then later on, we will be worried when we have narrow band or band-limited transmissions. And that's going to come in there. OK. In the last few minutes of this lecture, what we're going to talk about is doing this lecture. What happens is we're going to look at something called flat fading channels. And so we implement these rather readily using any sort of computer simulator. So how many people use MATLAB? MATLAB, hey, ich back in MATLAB. Yeah. And, I'm not going to ask about Simulink, because that's much more specific. Anybody do scientific programming, just use programming? C programmers? A little bit? No? No? A little bit? Okay. So people know a little bit about C. The thing is, what it comes down to it. So let's say we look at an indoor model in general. And so there's a reason why I brought up Rayleigh and Ricing, because this is what I mean by channel modeling. What you can do is you can model multipath propagation just like in this room, like my voice. So here, like, you know, Wiglinski's voice propagate through the room. Much more impressive than Grand Canyon, right? Because the walls and the size of the echo chamber is so much larger. Wireless signals, on your hand, also, because it's a wave, propagates through the medium, reflects off the walls, and then is received in many copies. And unlike the human ear in the process where, you know, if I hear echo, 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 I can distinguish what the words are being spoken. If the echoes are too close together, it's like, oh, 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 oh. It might sound very disturbing, but my brain is able to process it. Now imagine if you had a dumb receiver that does not have a human brain attached to it. Right, a wireless receiver receives all the echoes. Which one is the right one to choose? How do I recover that signal? I would use an equalizer, right? So I would have the opposite of the wireless channel reversing. I would basically have a filter that would undo, if you will, that reverberation. And we call it that in terms of, let's say, a mathematical model. You would have your different components that are bounced off, and each component would be multiplied by some sort of amplitude AK, and would have a phase. Why? Why is the phase rotating? So amplitude should make sense, right? In high school physics, so I went to a public school, but almost Canada went to a public school, both university and high school. The people that went to a private school, well, I don't know where to get the money for that. But anyways, what happens is you probably have dealt with the ripple tank in physics. So you have these two little beads that hits the water surface, you have the waves, and then you saw things of superposition. The two peaks make a super peak, two troughs make a super trough, and then a peak and a trough cancel each other and make it becomes flat. What happens is, this happens in the wireless environment too. I send out a signal, it goes all over the place, it goes at a Wi-Fi access point over there, and that Wi-Fi access point might receive two or three copies of my wireless signal at the same time, and might constructively superimpose or destructively superimpose, eliminating the signal. And that is random. And we can characterize it statistically by a Rayleigh random variable. Ah, that's where we get Rayleigh, right? At the same time, it's very interesting. People don't think about it. When your signal hits drywall, concrete wall, stone wall, wooden wall, there's a phase amount by the physics of that property when you imping upon it. And so at the end, that also attributes to that constructive or destructive combination of all those signals at that receiver, because what happens, all those signals arrive, there might be delays because light and energy travels at a finite rate through space. So my wireless signal is traveling at the speed of light, but it's finite. So the longer it travels, the later it will get to that access point. So we have delay contributions that can be exponentially distributed. We'll also have Rayleigh random fading of each component because they're added randomly, and the phase is rotating all over the place randomly. And it's beautiful. And what I know, but I mean, there's a wonderful paper by Slay and Valenzuela. I forgot which transaction it was in IEEE. And what this paper did is it came up with a statistical model. And it's all intuitive, but it makes total sense how you can characterize, let's say, an indoor wireless environment. Variables in order to describe inter-arrival times of different clusters of rays of copies of signals, and as well as in between each cluster, each copy of that cluster, and the amplitude and the decay rate of all that energy. And so you might wonder, okay, how do I implement all this? So, like, if you play with MATLAB, and again, something to do on the weekend, if you have nothing else, you want to have some fun, what you can do is, so Saleh and Valenzuela had this model where, let's say you have, oh, boop, so T. And so what ends up happening is, what they did is they were able to say, let's say if a signal is transmitted at time equals 0, at time equals t1, the first cluster of rays arrive at the receiver. And then at t equals t2, the next cluster of rays arrive. And so what that means is, essentially, here's my receiver, here's my transmitter. Let's say that's a room. The rays would bounce. There would be the direct path, bounce. Maybe it would bounce there, bounce there, bounce there, bounce there, and so on. So there are all these bounces, right? So we have clusters. And it turns out that the height of each of these clusters, the peak of those, can be Rayleigh. And what happens is the space, the time, the random instances of time separating this, the lead of this cluster and the lead of that cluster, can be described by an exponential random variable. It's known as a Poisson arrival process. The space in between each ray in a cluster, the inter-arrival time, can also be represented by an exponential random variable. The decay rate is exponential, both on the individual cluster as well as the clusters overall. And so that's what Saleh and Valenzuela came up with many, many decades ago. And so how do you model that in MATLAB? FIR filter. What happens is, look at that. Our transfer function, we take, let's say, a signal, and this guy here represents all the copies of the echoes and stuff that are going to arrive. Essentially, that's my FIR, that's an filter. So if you want to have fun with audio and make your own echo chamber, what you do is take your, record your speech, feed it into MATLAB, and create something that looks like that, and you're going to hear, hello, and then you can freak out your roommates and such, all right? So in a computer, what you would do is you would basically represent this as an FIR filter, where each one of these is a tap, and it's a tap delay. Now, there's some trickiness here, because the thing is, we're making an FIR filter because it's discrete. It happens at finite time instances, but these rays might not be confined to uniform time instances. So you're going to have to be a little bit careful of how you do that. All right? Okay. So in this lecture, what we've seen is essentially narrowband noise, which is cool. What we have also seen is a little bit about how we model things using computer technology. So with that, I think that concludes lecture 3 for tonight. So I'm going to let this thing stop, because basically if this goes on the internet,